I also have one. Me too.
That's perfect. And this is how we're going to start it. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls.
Everyone stay hydrated.
You know what? This is cool. I am talking to someone right now that I've been a huge fan of for quite some time. I've been watching Championship Wrestling from Hollywood. I've been watching New Japan Pro Wrestling. And of course, Santino's Brothers as well. You may have heard of this individual, ring announcer, commentator. This man has literally done it all in this business. And I do want to point out before I introduce this individual, there's some fun facts about this individual as well. In addition to his work with Championship Wrestling from Hollywood, he has also done in New Japan Pro Wrestling Strong, as well as the Lions Break Collision. He's also a prolific actor in high school and in college, performed in productions such as Romeo and Juliet, Guy and Dolls, and so much more, including a General Auto Insurance commercial. He's also an avid gamer, ran personal fighting game tournaments for his birthday, which is called the Adnan Invitational from 2004 to 2019, complete with poster graphic for each event. And also his favorite wrestlers include the ace Hiroshi Tanahashi, which I have to agree with you. That's one of my favorites of all time as well.
The greatest, dog.
The fallen angel, Christopher Daniels, the heartbreak kid, Shawn Michaels. And of course, how could we forget about Rocky Romero? So ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, let me introduce you to the one and only Adnan Qureshi. How are you?
I'm doing fantastic, Sock Monkey Mike. How are you doing on this day?
I am doing absolutely amazing, my friend. Like I mentioned before, this, like, you are such an inspiration. I mean, just watching your work from Championship Wrestling from Hollywood, United Wrestling Network, and New Japan, just the way that you showcase your voice and showcase the athletes in the ring, it's truly something special.
Well, I'm glad that you found it to be that way. It's been an honor and a privilege to be involved with the projects that I've been involved with, and it's still always quite shocking to me what I've been able to do in the time that I've been around. November 4th was my 3-year Wrestleversary since the very first show I ever did. So it's a crazy thing to think about what I've been able to do in that time and what I've been continuing to do in this pandemic. I just realized my Cuphead drawing is knocked over. Looking at that, so that let's go ahead and put. There you go. No, Cuphead, no. Stop falling. We're on television or the internet or something of the sort. Okay, there we go. Now you can see Cuphead. Perfect. But yeah, it's been just a real an honor and a privilege to be involved with the projects that I've been involved with, especially like considering that the time we live in right now, it's weird to think that I'm like probably one of the most working non-wrestlers in not just California, but the industry, I feel like right now, which is just crazy to think about.
Absolutely. And it's just that work ethic, I think, that just keeps you going, keeps you motivated, keeps you just striving for more and more and more. And that's what I love about your mentality when it comes to this business.
Oh, it's something that was instilled in me very early. Like you mentioned, I was trained by Santino Brothers Wrestling Academy. I was trained under Gentleman Jervis and referee Jeremy Marcus, as well as dabbled, obviously, under Joey Chaos as well, who's, you know, head honcho of everything. And, you know, got, you know, random tidbits and stuff from guys like Bateman and a lot of other people. And it was, you know, a great experience and gave me the correct values for being in professional wrestling, like the thing that was posted on the wall at the dojo, put in the work. That's the phrase that everybody in Santino Brothers who came through that dojo got that phrase. And the ones that you're seeing all over the place, those are the ones who put in the work. That's why you're looking at guys like Bateman in Ring of Honor and Brody King in Ring of Honor, Jake Atlas in NXT, and like so many people, so many places. It's just the coolest thing to see, you know, and I'm very happy to have come to where I came from, as well as the other non-wrestlers who came with me, like a Halston Body or an Alyssa Moreno, or, you know, it's just the coolest thing, honestly. And I owe a lot of, you know, I owe everything to Santino Brothers, because I wouldn't have been here if it wasn't for Santino Brothers, in all honesty.
Absolutely. And when you're speaking about Santino's Brothers, obviously such a decorated wrestling academy. I mean, I was talking to Vinny Wasco not too long ago, back in a couple months back. And same thing goes with Alyssa Moreno. And just the way that they describe Santino's Brothers, I feel like it's truly more than just a wrestling school per se. It's more where stars are born and they literally prepare you for the business.
Yeah, absolutely. They give you the right tools. It's what you do with those tools to make them work. They give you all the right values, and they have such a credible pedigree of the people that you see that's come out of the school. I mean, you think about who's training there, like a Joey Chaos, like a Robbie Phoenix, who's the head trainer. He's trained however many Southern California Rookies of the Year in a row. It's it's ridiculous to think about, like, how good it is of a school it has been. Like, not saying that there aren't other credible schools in Southern California. I just, you know, personally a little biased, but like Santino Brothers has really produced a lot of the cream of the crop, like not even just being seen here in the Southern California scene, but just now, like, people are noticing all over the world, and the name carries weight. You can see by the people who came through, like we talked about Alyssa. Alyssa was in the same class as me. We started at the same time on the same day, and I watched her, and she's one of the closest, my closest friends I made in wrestling, because we started together. And I was so happy when she was signed to WWE for that brief moment in time. And I was like that. And that was one of those things too. I saw coming at some point. I'm like, she's going to be the one who goes the farthest, I felt. And she's absolutely going to do wonders with whatever else she decides to do. And I mean, we still see her now. She's been appearing on the United Wrestling Network and Championship Wrestling from Hollywood again, until I'm sure she gets picked up by some other big thing again. Like, until she's going to always do well, because that's what we all saw. And I'm really happy to kind of have my name as a part of that legacy now to some degree. It's a trip to think about that all these awesome people came from there, and I'm proud to represent and always proud to recommend as well. Whenever Santino Brothers gets running again, I highly recommend it. If you are looking to get into professional wrestling as a wrestler or a non-wrestler now, I think it's the place to go.
Absolutely. And like you mentioned before, so much from the Southern California scene. It seems to me, and I don't know about you, but there's something about the Southern California wrestling scene compared to the Northern California scenes, compared to literally all these other areas in basically the majority of the United States, that there's so much talent coming from that particular area of the Southern California other area, whether that's coming from wrestlers, whether that's commentators, ring announcers, ring crew. Like, it happens to be the Southern California scene where it's really getting the proper recognition.
Yeah. You know, I think part of it is just the fact that, like, we've had all these big things that happen, because you think about the big cities in the United States. You think about Los Angeles is one, and that's Southern California, and then New York is the other big city. Or, like, you know, maybe you can think about, like, I don't know which part of Texas, like Dallas, Texas or something, like the big, or like Chicago, Illinois, or the other big cities. Like, you know, it's one of those hotbed places just in the United States in general. So when you consider the fact that people come to Los Angeles to try and make it in entertainment anyway, that's a big factor in it. So it brings people from all over the world. I'm not saying anything negative about any of the other places. There's great talent that comes from everywhere, but there's just something about the last decade of the talent that's been cultivated in Southern California that speaks for itself. Like the fact that Scorpio Sky and Peter Avalon are guys who got signed to AEW, and they're killing it in their own various ways. You know, I mean, the Young Bucks were California guys, man, too. They're from like Hesperia or something. No, Rancho Cucamonga. That's where they're from. They're like down, you know, a few hour drive down that way. But like, there was something special about here. I mean, New Japan Pro Wrestling had established an LA Dojo previously in the early 2000s. And then they have since reopened an LA dojo back in 2018. So they've got their foot back here. Championship Wrestling from Hollywood is the place to get a lot of great television experience as well. You know, it's another place in Southern California. And I just think they're, you know, you think also back to like PWG was like one of, is whenever they get back running, for the longest time, they've been a place that like so many stars would go out to wrestle for PWG, and so many big things happen to PWG, and so many memorable things happen. And you look at like half the people who wrestled on PWG ended up doing something big.
Oh yeah.
You know? Yeah. It's crazy. It's just, we just happen to be fortuitous enough to be around in this scene. And I think that benefits, you know, location, location, location. And in this particular case, SoCal is the location, I would say, especially in the last few years.
Absolutely. You talk about location, location, location. I don't know if you are a fan of the old school wrestling back in the, you know, olden times of the early 80s, late 70s.
Territory days.
The territory days. Now, I do have to ask, because I did ask this before, do you think now, thanks to the pandemic, that is more of a reality in these times, because there are so various limited, because you have AEW that's in Florida, you have Primetime Live, which is in Long Beach, Thunder Studios, you have WWE, which is based on Florida still. They're not really going anywhere else because of the pandemic. Do you think that that is living proof right now?
It's not necessarily the territory days in that same definition, because the territorial days referred to the fact that literally every part of the country was divided. So your world champion in this place was Ric Flair. Your world champion here was like Hulk Hogan. The other people who lived in like a different state didn't know Hulk Hogan was a world champion. And the other people who lived where Hulk Hogan was champion didn't know anything about Ric Flair. So it's a little different, because now we live in the internet age. You really can't have a territory divided in that particular way, because now you can watch wrestling from anywhere. Like when Impact did the Ring Kicking project in India, like I watched some of that, and that was really cool to see some of that. And I'm really sad that it didn't like stick around, because India was an interesting territory to look at, or a location to look at. It's major promotions. That's what you're looking at. So you're looking at your WWEs. You're looking at your AEWs. It's where your global is. Your New Japan, who has expanded now into the US, and you know they're a global product, because you can get their stuff pretty much anywhere. Impact has been around for almost 20 years now, so it's a interesting thing there. The NWA is thriving again, and you know it sucks that that power had to go on hiatus, but now with the partnerships with us at the United Wrestling Network, the NWA still has a spotlight. And I think also what we're doing with the United Wrestling Network is trying to give spotlight, obviously, to guys who haven't had it, not just people actually in Southern California, like what we have coming up tomorrow night on United Wrestling Network Primetime Live. I know in this particular case it'll be last week, but we have Manders, the one called Manders. We couldn't have him before, but he's not from California, and neither is Lindsay Snow. You know, she's not from Southern California, but like they're coming here to wrestle on Primetime Live, because it's got that spotlight, because we've had the NWA, we've had New Japan guys on there. It's a matter of putting people together people that you know. Obviously, that's the draw, is that you tune in to see Aaron Stevens and the question mark challenge for the NWA tag titles, as we did recently, or Nick Aldis defend the NWA world title, or the NWA women's champion. You tune in for that. But on top of that, you're going to see people that you've never seen or heard of before. And that's also a real treat. Like we have our United World Championship tournament going on, and a couple of things got changed around. Some people couldn't make the tournament last minute. And one of our guys, BHK Kevin Martinson, who's been around in the California scene for a long time. People even know him from PWG, from part of the Rocknest Monsters. Or even if you watch Lucha Underground, he was Son of Madness in Lucha Underground. But not enough people know that. And he had a big-time spotlight main event against Mike Bennett, who everybody knows Mike Bennett. Ring of Honor, Impact, WWE, now with us at the United Wrestling Network. And they had a awesome main event match, and everybody knows who Mike Bennett is. But now some people who watch that go, well, I know who this Kevin Martinson guy is. And, you know, and that's I think what the beauty of what like Primetime Live is doing, is trying to get showcase. And that's honestly like the beauty of what AEW is doing with AEW Dark, that a lot of guys on Dark get an opportunity that you've never seen before, like some guys that we know here, like Ray Rosas, Watts, Heather Monroe. You know, those people getting the opportunity, it's the greatest thing to see. But it's better when we are able to do stuff like that. That's the same thing we did with the Collision, with New Japan Pro Wrestling Collision and Lions Break, Lions Break Collision and New Japan Strong. You know, there's your New Japan USA guys and some guys that were starting to make names for themselves that got to be able to show themselves off, like an Alexander, a Blake Christian, who people have seen in Game Changer Wrestling, or guys who I know at like the DKC, Dylan Kyle Cox, who's the Santino brother, who started the same one-day training with me, which is a whole different story, and it's crazy just to think about him on New Japan Strong, or like Adrian Quest. There's all these guys, you know, it's the cream is rising to the top. The guys who – it's really cool to see people get the opportunity who people aren't able to – who have never heard of or never got the chance to be heard of. It's a really interesting time, and I think, you know, despite the fact that we're in the weirdest time in pro wrestling, I think a lot of creative things are happening because of it.
Absolutely. And there's so much special things. Although, yes, there is not a crowd the majority of the time with these tapings. Of course, there is New Japan where it is having its fans back. But of course, we already know what the New Japan crowd is. Always silent, but always popping for the certain spots in a wrestling match. But going aside from that really quick, I do want to talk about your beginnings in the broadcasting industry. And I find it very, very interesting as well, because you did, like I mentioned before earlier in the interview, started off as an actor, did all these gigs before. So can you talk about that transition for you to going into the broadcasting booth, being behind the, ring announcing or commentary?
You know, it's funny because, I always had a passion for being on stage and being the center of attention in some manner. You know, I was an actor back in high school, and then that transitioned to me acting in college and whatnot. And I really always just loved doing productions and being in shows. It's funny, the production of Romeo and Juliet that we did was actually very interesting, and a very different one that we had did was actually where the interpretation we did, it wasn't like a traditional like Shakespearean version. We used the same words, but we had made the setting in at the time, which was more like timely when we actually set the show in Afghanistan, where the Montagues were like Afghani citizens, and the Capulets were Afghani citizens, and the Montagues were like occupying U.S. military force. So it made it a very interesting kind of show in that aspect, and like doing guys in the hall doing musicals and stuff like that, and so much stuff that I did, and it helped me, be obviously because I'm a performer. I've always been a performer, and that never left me. Now the transition really became where I got into Santino Brothers for their one day like intensive training. That's where I met the DKC, where he started. So that was like a day's worth of wrestling training that you paid for, and you kind of see if it was right for you, and I beat my body up and it was a good time, and then I couldn't get up the next morning. But really struck me when we did the character stuff as the last part of it with Gentleman Jervis, and the funniest thing was cutting promos, and like I cut a promo on DKC and it was awesome and it was great. And then like later on in that year, I was like, after that I was like, I don't know if I can wrestle. I'd like to, but I'm not sure. But then later they offered their first ever managers, referees, announcers, ring announcers course, which now is referred to as the Advocates class for Santino Brothers. So I'm like, all right, I wanted to be a character. I always wanted to be a character. And I am also a character that got slowed. Like, I haven't done any of the manager stuff ever since the pandemic hit. But, there's a manager that looks almost exactly like me for some odd reason, whose name is Ty the Super. I don't know why. He's also kind of an asshole. I don't know. He's like, he leads the group called the Dominations at Santino Brothers Up All Night, which is a group of Asian wrestlers. And, but it's weird how much me and him look alike. But in any case, we did manager stuff and whatnot. And then I got thrown into the first show I did November 4, 2017. I was like maybe like only a month or two into training, and I was setting up and paying my dues, like getting the ring set up and chairs and all that. And Joey Chaos, Santino Brothers Maestro, is like, Adnan, you're ring announcing tonight. I just go, what? Excuse me? Because if you look at the pictures and the first time I'm doing it, I'm wearing jeans.
All right.
And I'm not ready. But I had a suit jacket because my commentary partner that night, because I did commentary and ring announcing, which I did do for a while at Santino Brothers, while I was both at the same time. Marty Quinn, or Tim Fairplay, as he'd be known too, he let me borrow his jacket. And then it kind of spun from there, where I knew I wanted to be a commentator for sure. Like, I love doing commentary. I love trying to tell the story of a match. It's the greatest thing, I think, that I would love more opportunities than that. Not saying I'm not grateful for being a ring announcer and being the handsome voice that I am and stuff like that, because being a ring announcer is probably what I'm known primarily for, and I'm grateful for that. but I do miss doing commentary so very much, because I did commentary for like a year. Well, I was doing commentary the whole time, but like a year and a half for Santino Brothers before they transitioned me out of commentary to just being a ring announcer. And then, doing commentary for Inoki Dojo, getting the opportunity to do it at Ground Zero down in San Diego, which was phenomenal and a fantastic experience. And I think I was going to get more of that commentary stuff down there until the pandemic hit. But the transition was more so not as difficult as you would think, because wrestling is performance. And I was already used to performing, you know. The thing that, you know, is getting used to is how you do it a little differently, or in the fact of like doing championship wrestling from Hollywood, that is a broadcast, or Primetime Live, it's a live broadcast. It's learning the ins and outs of like TV and the technical terms and whatnot, but it's more so doing what you already know how to do, but maybe finding out the minute details that you need to do for broadcast compared to live crowd or internet or something like that. You know what I mean?
Right.
How you want to present things, every show is going to be different. Like, a ring announcer for what we do, like for United Wrestling, like even just doing it between like Hollywood and United, like I do it basically the same for them. But if I do it for New Japan, it's completely different because there's a certain format, a different way that they do it there. Or if I was to do like one of those really hardcore shows, like never done one, but like, you notice how like are way different, you know, there's a different vibe depending on whatever show you do. Like I love doing wrestling, pro wrestling. I'm usually a character there. I'm usually Midnight Turkey over there.
Right.
And I've also done stuff like Drunk Santa and stuff like that. So it's so cool. It's so cool because there's so many different flavors of wrestling, but you have to just figure out where you fit in, if you want to fit everywhere, whatnot. It's what I teach what I've taught my students is something that was taught to me was get in where you fit in. Like, you know, there's never going to be one spot. I think it's one of those important things. I think anyone trying to get into wrestling, especially as a non-wrestler, get in where you fit in. Because, yeah, you may not, you know, want to do this thing that you're doing, but it can lead to what you're doing. And that's the important thing, you know, is there's not one way to do things. You have to be ready to do anything and everything. And then maybe you can have that transition to the thing that you really want to do. You know, that's what you have to be mindful of.
Absolutely. And just the passion that you're talking about when it comes to your position is so influential. Cause like, again, as a person that always believes in the same passion, I've always had the same passion ever since I was 10 years old of this business. So it's always it's crazy to think just, you know, seeing the other passion just really inspires me as an aspiring broadcaster to just keep going, to keep, you know, pursuing that passion.
Yeah, good, man. You got to have passion, you know, first and foremost. You know, if you're not in this business because you love this business, then what are you doing in this business? You know, Yeah, it'd be weird to talk to somebody who's like, hey, like, you know, what was your favorite match of all time? It's like, I don't watch wrestling. Why are you in wrestling? What are you doing here? It'd be the weirdest thing. I've yet to have that, you know, where I'm like, what is this? Unless they're just like a random person who's there to help for a day or something like that. Like, it's nothing like, you know, if you're in it for the long run, you got to have a passion for it. And that's not just wrestling. That's anything. You got to have a passion for streaming. If you're a streamer or like, you know, being a basketball player or being a scientist, you have to have the passion for it. Otherwise, you're going to be miserable, man.
Absolutely. I always felt like that your career should be something that you should relatively love every single day doing it. It shouldn't be really something that it's like, oh, man, well, I got to be a commentator today.
Exactly. Like I'm ready to, that's what led to me being like a turkey and stuff like that. That was me getting in where I fit in and just having a good time doing any of that stuff. So yeah, of course.
Absolutely. And speaking about adding on, I do want to mention the very dashing nickname that you do have, Dashing Adnan. Can you talk to us about where that originated from?
I just ripped it off from Cody Rhodes. Not even joking. Like literally, like I started that Twitter. Like, so that is my Twitter and my Instagram. So follow me at the Dashing Adnan, both places to follow me. I started that Twitter in 2011, 2010. I did it because you remember Z True Long Island Story, the Zack Ryder YouTube show. He did like some costume contest or something where you followed him on Twitter and you sent pictures of yourself in costumes. Well, I made a Zack Ryder costume. Like, I don't know, when I was 20 or something. I don't remember like how old I was or when this was now exactly the time frame. But the only reason I ever started that Twitter was to follow Zack Ryder for this thing. And I was thinking, what do I put as my Twitter handle? And I thought, and you know, Dashing Cody Rhodes was a thing at the time. And people would say, you know, I'd try and compare myself to that. So I put the Dashing Adnan as basically just a ripoff of Dashing Cody Rhodes. And so that's where it came from. It was literally that. And then it's funny because the Twitter thing even came back up. It's like, Adnan, it's your like 10th year anniversary on Twitter or whatever it was. And I just remember tweeting at Matt Cardona. It's like, the only reason I started this Twitter was to follow Matt Cardona during Z True Long Island Story. And he quote tweeted like, this is pretty cool. I'm like, oh, that's cool. Thanks, Matt. Yeah. Maybe a follow if you're watching this, Matt, at the Dashing Adnan. That'd be pretty cool if you want to follow me. So there was that. And then I never changed it. It always fit. And I think the funniest thing is my friend Chris Bay, who is now in Impact Wrestling, Chris Bay, which is the dopest thing, and I'm so happy for him, has his Twitter handle and his Instagram handle is Dashing Chris Bay. And I always wanted to have us both in an interview or something where I'm interviewing him, and I just wanted both our handles to show up, and it'd just say, be Dashing Odd, not Dashing Chris Bay. The handsome thing came from the first character that I was trying to do in the Santino Brothers class was Handsome Hassan Kim. And so, you know, I did that. And then when I started doing, you know, the stuff in broadcasting, as far as being an announcer and a ring announcer and a commentator and all that, I decided to just, instead of being Handsome Hassan Kim, I would just call make my nickname the Handsome Voice. If I'm going to be, that's how I would introduce myself on a Santino Brothers show, like the Handsome Voice Adnan Qureshi, or any other show that if I'm like ring announcer, I do it at the Championship Wrestling for Hollywood when we have a crowd, like Handsome Voice Adnan Qureshi, how you guys doing today? You guys ready for some wrestling? Yeah, you know, stuff like that. Which is always funny because I feel like nobody gets it right, because Dan Joseph and Dustin Starr both refer to me as the Golden Voice. And I don't correct them. I'm just like, yeah, Golden Voice, that's right. It's not the right thing. But yeah, I love those guys. You know, so it's just nice to know that, you know, people think, you know, nicely of me and have been trying to, you know, refer to me by the moniker. But that's basically the story of the Twitter handle and the nickname.
Now, I do have to ask, since I was going to refer to something else, but you know what? I'm so interested in this now. Has Cody Rhodes contacted you through Twitter and Instagram about it?
No, of course not. No, I've met Cody a couple times, like once as a fan. I have a picture when he was at the Wrestling Guy store, which I know you've been to the Wrestling Guy store.
Oh, of course.
Yeah. Plug for them. You can pay me back later, David. I met Cody. He's a very nice dude. And then, like, you know, it was me and a couple of my best friends, Edward and Leanne. We met him and have this great picture with him and Brandy. And then, you know, I'd seen Cody. I'd been around Cody one other time, and that was when he was the NWA World's Heavyweight Champion. After he won it all in, he made an appearance at Championship Wrestling from Hollywood. And there's like a brief clip in the 10 Pounds of Gold episode where Cody makes that appearance of me opening the door for him. That's like, sweet, I'm in 10 Pounds of Gold. Yeah. Although I'm in a couple of 10 Pounds of Golds, I think, as a ring announcer for a couple things. So there's definitely some of that. But that was the only other time I was around Cody. And he was always really cool just in general. But no, at no point did I tell him, like, hey, by the way, I started my Twitter handle because of your old dashing gimmick. Like, he even quote tweeted me when I was promoting the CWF appearance, CWFH appearance, when he came to Hollywood. I don't think he noticed what my handle was, but he would just like, come out tonight or whatever. But no, I've never told him that. And I don't think it's necessarily something I need to tell him. But if it ever comes out in conversation, I think that'd be pretty funny. Also, Cody, if you're watching this, follow me at the
Dashing. Oh, yeah. Me too, if you can. I'm just kidding.
Yeah. Right
there. Of course. But when we do talk about Dashing Adnan, of course, we always talk about the passion that you have for this business. You have a passion for what you do. But I do want to mention Championship Wrestling from Hollywood in particular, because again, you talk about, to me, it feels so much like Championship Wrestling from Hollywood is the old Saturday night WCW shows, or it kind of feels like what, you know, of course, NWA Power. Of course, there's that type of style of show where it's taped in front of a live audience. You know, it's wrestling. You see the promos on their live. Of course, you have Raw and SmackDown and NXT where you have your regular stuff. But it seems like Championship Wrestling from Hollywood and Primetime Live, it really gives you that show vibe where it's in front of a live audience. You feed off the crowd with when it becomes the when it comes to the professional wrestlers, when it comes to the ring announcers. It really gives you that show feel.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. You know, a crowd is a big thing. You know, it's, you know, it's interesting now we're living in a time where we don't have the crowd, but you know, the crowd is obviously something that drives us. And it's, and when you have that great energy, it adds so much to it. That was the big success with NWA Power, is that they had the right crowd for what they were doing. And, you know, the Hollywood crowd, you know, they're the guys who we see all the time. Those are the guys who are showing up, and they're really passionate about the guys that we're presenting, and they've been going there for forever. You know what I mean? And I would imagine they'd be loving it if they could make it down to Primetime Live. You know what I mean? That'd be, because we're doing so much good stuff. But you know, it's cool. Like, I remember my favorite, like, too, was when we did the Coastline Clash show for Hollywood last year, 2019, because we were at the Irvine Improv. And that was one of the most electric atmospheres I have ever been a part of, honestly. Like it, you know, being at the Improv, it was so different. The Improv had never hosted professional wrestling before. And here we are, where we had that was when we did the second David Arquette match, where David Arquette had the match with Peter Avalon. I just remember the crowd just being like so hyped for just like, you know, wrestling. You know, in the Irvine Improv. And it was so cool. And one of my favorite experiences with a crowd, or like when I got to do, you know, because we co-promoted with them when Impact Wrestling was here last year, for the 3 days, well, one of the spots was in the Champion Wrestling from Hollywood spot. One is the Esports Arena. One was in Hollywood, and all those crowds were awesome too. And just, you really feed off it. Like, you know, absolutely. You're not wrong about that. And the thing is too, that's part of my job that people don't see, is I have to keep the crowd entertained also. And you know, they got to keep them hype in between too. So like those moments where there's the commercial breaks, like we're setting up certain things or whatnot, there's a lot of times I'm just like there and I'm just like, hey guys, don't forget, we got huge main event, Hollywood Heritage titles on the line, woo, stuff right. Like that. After the end of the day, I'm tired.
Oh,
I spend all my energy to make them just as hype as me and keep their energy up for a show. You know, it's so I, even though I love a crowd, I am less tired these days for that particular aspect of it. But you know, it's an interesting thing, because yeah, you feed off that crowd. Now with the no crowd shows, you have to figure out different ways to get your energy and get hype about it. But I think that also creates a lot of different creative liberties, as we've been taking. If you've noticed, like watching the new Championship Wrestling Hollywood episodes, like there's a lot of different creative stuff that's been happening ever since we've restarted reshooting that, like, we couldn't do with an audience, for example. Right. So it's left us a lot of creative liberties and freedoms to do things differently, like the gigantic backstage, the gigantic brawl where the whole locker room spilled out, and I'm in the brawl holding Nico Marquez, and he's shoving me, and I have to go pick him back. It's like, and Todd Kelly's like, Adnan's in the brawl. What's he doing in the brawl? He's gonna get killed or something like that. Whatever he's saying during that, something we couldn't do with a live audience. But it also kind of makes you wonder, if we did that with a live audience, how crazy would that be? We're just like, we're like, I almost feel like we'd start a riot where the crowd would just get up and be like, we're gonna fight him too. It's like, oh my god, that would be such a liability issue, let me tell you. You know, but yeah, the crowd is obviously going to be something that we look forward to seeing whenever we can get a vaccine out there or something, hopefully in the next year or so, man, just because, like, you know, it's the time that we live in. But I have faith in the people who are hard at work trying to figure things out with what's going on in the world, like as far as, like, you know, figuring out what works and what doesn't work on this virus and whatnot. And I look forward to everybody. I just look forward to hugging people again too. That's what I miss the most, is hugging my friends.
Oh, absolutely. And speaking about your friends that you do work alongside with, Alyssa Marino is one of them. Joe Galli is one of them. Todd Kenley. The list goes on and on about the talent that you work with. Can you talk to us about what it's like being in that conversation with those type of legendary commentators?
You know, it's an honor to be in any conversation with anyone that I'm involved with in general. Like a lot of these people, like a Todd Kennelly, like he's a guy who's been around for a long time, done a lot of really great things. He was with Impact for a while. He's called matches with Kurt Angle and AJ Styles and all these great names. You know, it's a trip. And that guy is a guy I've ridden with now. You know, he's a good dude. Me and him talked about like arcade cabinets for like the longest time. Bill Galli is, you know, who you've had on the show. He's incredible because he's now the voice of the NWA in a lot of ways. And then he's still an incredible broadcast journalist as far as the stories that he covers, man. I'm just going to shout out to him for, like, he's really covering the hard hitting stuff, man. He's doing like the stuff about like the racism stuff. And that hits home with me because he's a white person covering this stuff. And I commend him for that as a non-white person. Like, that's why I love a guy like Joe, Alyssa Marino. She was amazing from day one as a human being and as an announcer, as a commentator. She's good at everything that she does. Her show, Let's Get Cereal, hashtag Let's Get Cereal. Well, let's see you later. Hashtag Let's Get Cereal. You can watch that stuff too. She's such a vibrant and extraordinary personality. And it shows when you're watching these people. That's why there's a reason that the people who are where you see them, there's a reason that they're there. They're not there by chance. They're not there by accident. And if they're there by accident, you won't see them a second time. You know, these are people mm-hmm. who you're seeing, you know, persist over the time that they've been on, you know, and it's just cool that I've been around these people and watched them succeed and then watching me succeed. Like, I'm giving them kudos. They're giving me kudos. Like, it's just an honor. Like being able to work with New Japan Pro Wrestling recently, being around like a guy who I listened to in my early years as a kid, Kevin Kelly, like watching him like do the interviews with The Rock and hearing him do commentary for like episodes of like Shotgun Saturday Night or whatever it was that was on and stuff like that. Or I was, when I got into Ring of Honor, Kevin Kelly was the voice of Ring of Honor when I was watching it. And then now all of a sudden I'm there with Kevin Kelly taking a picture with him, who I got some advice from him by a tweet when I started. And then I could tell him, like, that's one guy I did tell, like, hey, you gave me advice via a tweet, and now here we both are. I took a picture with him because I had to. This is one of those type of things that I like, having these full circle moments of like seeing where what I've started and what I've done, what I said I was going to do, and seeing it kind of come full circle. It's the coolest thing. But like, these people, they are where they are because they're that good. They're the reason. There's a reason they are where they are. And I love those people. I support those people and will always hope for success for those people.
Absolutely. And when you are, it feels like, I don't know about you, but for me at least, when you get to work with the people that you look up to and yeah. to work with them or to just see them, like, same thing. If I saw Jim Ross, you know, mm-hmm. again, God willing that the pandemic is over at that time.
And,
you know, just to be in the presence of someone that I looked up to so long, same thing goes. I'm going to throw in a baseball reference, Vin Scully, someone that I really looked for, you know, looked up to.
Baseball, but I know the name, and that's proof of how big that guy's name was, is that it's not even a sport I watch and I know the name, you know. That's it. Transition transcends that particular sport, just like Jim Ross's name transcends pro wrestling, in all honesty. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. And just being, you know, in the presence of those or just meeting your heroes, it's so surreal. It feels like a kid in the candy store, in a sense.
What kind of candy do you like? What's your favorite candy? What makes you tick, Mike? What kind of candy do you want?
Honestly, any candy works with me.
Okay, I'm like a cookies and cream kind of guy. Those are really
okay. Okay, I see. Exactly. So speaking about what you're doing, Adnan, I do want to mention one unique thing that you are a part of when it comes to New Japan Pro Wrestling, and that's the fact that you consider Tanahashi the best wrestler in your eyes, your favorite. Can you talk to the people about where that fandom started? And how close is your relationship with Tanahashi?
I unfortunately have no real relationship with him because, you know, I've not, you know, he can't come over while we're doing Strong, at least that I've seen. So, like, I wish that'll be the thing. If he gets to do New Japan Strong, I will be like I have to contain my excitement if I ever like am on a set for Strong and it's like, there's Tanahashi. It's like, oh, but we have not had Tanahashi on New Japan Strong, but like it started actually the first time I ever saw Hiroshi Tanahashi, because I was a huge TNA guy watching mm-hmm. like when I was growing up, like in my teenage years, because there was a period of time where I just fell out with WWE. Like, I was tired of what I was watching. And I discovered TNA from like 2005. I remember it. I watched TNA for a long time, which was also a trip later in life to do Impact, which is essentially TNA, like, and, you know, announced like the X Division title, like one of my favorite championships growing up. But like the first match, it's because at the time TNA used to have a working relationship with New Japan Pro Wrestling. That's starting to happen a little bit with Chris Bay being announced for the Super J Cup tournament on December 12th. But so they announced, I think it was turning point of that year, where AJ Styles had a match with a Hiroshi Tanahashi. And I had no idea who Hiroshi Tanahashi was. And at the time, he was the U30 champion, which is a belt that not many people know about, which was a short-lived championship, which I thought was great in concept. Do you know what the U30 belt was?
No.
The U30 belt was a under 30 years old championship. I thought it was a great idea to showcase young talent. And Tanahashi, it only was held by two people before he was retired. Tanahashi and Shinsuke Nakamura. I wonder if I've heard that name before too. Anyway, Tanahashi was the U30 champion. He had a match with AJ Styles. And then I think he had a second match that was like online, I think, with Roderick Strong. And I remember like thinking like that guy was pretty cool. But I never saw him again. And then years later, I YouTubed, like, I think either AJ Styles Japan matches or New Japan matches or something. And I saw AJ Styles versus Hiroshi Tanahashi. And this is like 2007, 2008 Tanahashi at that point. That's when he's starting to really become the ace. Like, he'd already become IWGP Heavyweight Champion. And he was appearing on Impact a couple times. And then he wasn't, because he had like this random ladder match that had like the Dudleys in it and stuff like that. And I also have him on a DVD where he's in like a six-man X Division match, just like him and Sanjay Dutt and Eric Young. And I forget who the other three is. I have to look at the DVD, but like he's in that match too. And I just remember thinking, man, this guy is handsome. Look at that hair. Look at that. Like, he's a good looking man. I always say he's the best looking man that Japan's ever produced. But in general, like he was an incredible wrestler, and watching his match with AJ Styles in like 2007, 2008 in New Japan was really great. And I remember thinking, damn. And then later in life, watching him when New Japan World became a thing. I remember I signed up for New Japan World specifically for Wrestle Kingdom 9,
okay,
which was one of Tanahashi Okada matches, and AJ Styles was still in New Japan. And just remember watching Tana and just being like, he's so incredible. He makes you believe. Wrestling still feels real when I watch Tanahashi, because he absolutely makes you believe. Especially, I think, one of my favorite Tanahashi matches, I think, if you haven't watched it, you should look it up. It's the G1 Climax. It's AJ Styles' last G1 Climax, I can tell you. Yes. I can't remember the year. But it was essentially like them on the final night of A or B block, but it was AJ Styles versus Tanahashi. They were matched up again. Because I think those guys are perfect opponents. AJ Styles and Tanahashi have amazing matches together, and that's their best match. And my favorite match of theirs, and it's one that like I remember always being so incredible. And every time I see it, it's still such a great match. And the thing is, AJ Styles told a great story about like Tanahashi's his connection to the fans. That's which is 100% true. He is the hero of New Japan Pro Wrestling. He is the man, and he will always be. Like, he's the truest babyface in the sense, in all senses of the world, in of the word. He had Tanahashi in the Calf Killer, his submission, and Tanahashi is reaching and whatnot, and then AJ Styles is thinking, it's like, why isn't he hasn't grabbed the ropes yet, to break the hold? And he said that what he found out was Tana didn't grab the ropes yet because he could see women in the front row crying. Because they didn't want him to tap out. He wanted to milk as much emotion out of it as possible. Because he's a man who makes you believe. He's the once-in-a-century talent for a reason. He's the ace of New Japan Pro Wrestling for a reason. He's the 8-time IWGP Heavyweight Champion for a reason. It's because he is the embodiment of what a great professional wrestler should be. He's believable. He's a hero. He's a fantastic in the ring. I just watch some of his backstage comments sometimes and go, that man's not cutting a wrestling promo. He's talking to the people. And I feel like there's a difference in doing that too. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. And the way that
he's an inspiring individual, man.
Absolutely. And the way that you describe Tanahashi, really, for those who are a fan of me, know how much I'm a fan of Johnny Gargano. And that's how I describe him as well. Just the way that he brings you in with his professional wrestling.
You mean pre, right now, living with the Garganos kind of Gargano? Before, like trying to get that first NXT championship Gargano. And now he kind of hates you now, I'd say. Just a tad. Stop cheering for him. That's what he wants.
Oh, right, yeah. Well, I mean, compare that to...
Oh, yeah, for sure. I know exactly what you're saying. Yeah.
Yeah, so once again, Adnan, I do want to thank you so much for being a part of this. But before you go, though, I do have one final question for you, and this is probably going to be the hottest question of the entire interview. You see, you have worked with New Japan. You have worked with so many companies, Santino's Brothers, right now currently with United Wrestling Network. You know, of course, Championship Wrestling from Hollywood. There's so much that you have already done in your decorated career thus far. Is there a chance that Adnan will be seen, whether that's by the end of 2020, 2021, will we see Adnan be a part of either All Elite Wrestling or World Wrestling Entertainment in the near future? Or even Impact?
Never say never. I can tell you 100% right now, there is currently nothing in the cards. But never say never, you know, that's the thing, is that I'm open to doing anything. I am still currently technically a free agent. I do not have a contract to any promotion. So if there are promotions watching that have seen, like, that can, that know what I've done and whatnot, like, I'm technically a free agent. I have not, I've not talked to anyone from all, I know people at All Elite Wrestling. I know people in WWE. Which is the weirdest thing for me to even say, like, but I've not, I don't ask them, like, hey, can I get a job? No, it's not like I could, or what do I have to do? Like, you know, I'm not trying to whisper my way into those conversations like that necessarily. If those companies take notice of me, they're going to take notice of me for the right reasons, and then the call will come. So never say never, but I can safely say I feel for the rest of 2020, I would say no, but who knows what's in store for 2021 in 3 years. Like, New Japan was the goal for me. Like, I would love nothing more than for them to accept me fully. Outside of an appearance by appearance basis, I love New Japan Pro Wrestling with all my heart. But that doesn't mean I can't, you know, right now I'm not signed to anyone right now. So whether it be Adnan officially with New Japan, Adnan officially with Impact Wrestling, or MLW, or AEW, or WWE, the cards will show themselves when they show themselves. The 3 years that I've had have been the most incredible of my entire life. And New Japan was the goal. I can't believe I'm doing stuff with them currently. I'm going to enjoy it for as long as that keeps going on. It's been a dream come true. And if New Japan wants to keep me in a full-time capacity, I'm there for it. If AEW is interested, we'll talk turkey. If WWE is interested, I'm all ears. So you heard it here if you're watching from any of those companies. My DMs are open at @TheDashingAdnan, or you can email me at bookhandsomevoice@gmail.com. And that's also another place you can contact me. But I have other plugs I can do as well.
Go ahead.
You know where you can find me? You can find me on Twitter and Instagram at @TheDashingAdnan. You can watch New Japan Strong every Friday night, 7 p.m. Pacific time. NJPWworld.com. Sign up, 999 yen a month. And also next month, December 12th, we will be presenting in the U.S. the Super J Cup 2020 live. Absolutely live. You know, it's going to be awesome to watch, you know, to be part of the Super J Cup. You know, it's going to be crazy. Like, I can tell you right now, I have been asked to do Super J Cup. So I will be part of Super J Cup, which is already a trip. You know, that I'll be there on December 12th. But other than that, like, you know, New Japan Strong every Friday night, which is awesome. Every Tuesday night, Fight TV and pay-per-view, United Wrestling Network Primetime Live. I know you're going to air it on the week that we are doing our United World Championship Tournament Final. Mike Bennett versus Chris Dickinson, one of those two men, will become our first ever United World Champion. It's going to be exciting. So if you're watching this before Tuesday, then purchase it. If you're watching it after that Tuesday, purchase it, because it's on demand. Also, you can get the episodes in a pack. Every Saturday night at 1 a.m. on KDOC in Los Angeles, Championship Wrestling from Hollywood. It's the background of this episode. So much good talent that can be seen there, too. You've seen guys from all over the place that show up there, and so many stars show up there first, go somewhere else. Scorpio Sky, a Hollywood original, All Elite Wrestling guy. Championships of Wrestling from Hollywood can also be watched completely free on Fight TV on demand anytime. You can watch the entire near 500 episode catalog. We just shot episode 500. And all I'm going to tell you about the stuff that's happening is I'm in danger a lot. That's true. So watch Championship Wrestling from Hollywood and watch me potentially almost die. That's what's going to make you watch right now. So watch all that. Other than that, like, yeah, I'm very excited for all that stuff. Follow Sock Monkey Mike too. Oh, there. I'll point that way. There you go. But yeah, I'm very excited though for all the stuff that's going up. So yeah, please watch all that. Super J Cup, Strong, all that stuff. So.
Well, Ivan, thank you once again, Adnan. And again, thank you for not just being a positive role model and a positive influence, but also just being a role model for those aspiring broadcasters who want to go into interviewing, wrestling, when it comes to broadcasting, or you know, commentary, ring announcing, whatever the case may be. We do want to thank you for being that.
Mm-hmm. Oh, no, thank no. I'm glad I could inspire you. You know, if you like what you heard, give me the follow. If you're looking for some advice, tweet me. If you need some advice or something, tweet me, and I'll probably give you terrible advice about like eating popsicles at 1 a.m. and it'll have nothing to do with what you asked me, but it's what I'm going to respond with. So in any case, though, in all honesty, it's put in the work. You know, don't forget to just put in the work. And things aren't going to happen for you immediately either. You know, you have to, you know, you're going to get what you put out of it, but you got to give it time sometimes, you know. And the people are always watching. Even when you don't think they're watching, they're always watching. So also keep that in mind too, you know. And that's, I think, what helped get me to the places that I've been, in all honesty. So I'm just happy to have done what I've done. I appreciate you wanting to talk to me. That's also just an honor that people want to talk to me. So thank you very much. So, yeah, appreciate it.
Of course. And until we meet again, guys, before we go, make sure you follow the Dashing Adnan on all social medias. Make sure the links will be down in the description. Also, it's displayed right over there. And, of course, New Japan Wrestling, you can find them anywhere. Link will be down in the description below. Primetime Live, Championship Wrestling from Hollywood. So much.
So much.
You can find...
It's a weird time, but it's a good time for the wrestling that's happening. I'll tell you that.
Of course. So until we meet again, I will see you guys in the next interview.